Hi, this is Lisa Balsera with USF Health. Thank you so much for joining us today. It is National Awareness Month for Ovarian Cancer, and I am delighted to be joined today by Dr. Tom Rutherford. Dr. Rutherford has over 30 years' experience in treating patients with cancer. So Dr. Rutherford, tell us more about this disease that is really a silent killer, and what are the symptoms for it?
Well, ovarian cancer is known as a disease that whispers. And unfortunately, most people have the disease for 18 to 24 months prior to actual having a diagnosis of ovarian cancer. And the reason is we have symptoms. You go out to dinner, you have dinner, you have a little bit of an upset stomach, but it goes away. And then 3 or 4 months later, you do something else, and I shouldn't have had the fish or the spaghetti sauce. So a symptom that recurs off and on, we often can admit to other reasons for. As it gets more advanced, what we find is we start having some bloating, we have some changes in our bowel or bladder function. We find that, you know, the tight-fitting jeans that we had, now I'm in sweatpants, and it starts rapidly accumulating. Then you start noticing fatigue. If you have a lot of fluid in the abdomen, you can have shortness of breath. And that's really where we start seeing the patients diagnosed, unfortunately. And at that point, it would be an advanced stage cancer.
And this can be detected, though, also through your yearly physical?
So it's important to have exams. It's important to know your family history. So if you would be considered a high-risk family, so the cancers that go together are ovarian, breast, uterine, colon, prostate, pancreatic cancers. So if you have a family history that relatives are dying from these diseases or have these diseases, then you are at a higher risk, possibly, of having an ovarian cancer. What's important is to know the genetics of the disease. So the most common that we know of is the BRCA1 and the BRCA2. And that can be done through genetic testing. So based on the family history, will dictate do you need to have genetics. But even if the genetics are negative and your family history is significant, if the family's all negative for the genes that we currently know, then we still need to follow you much more closely.
And tell us about the therapy. I know you're part of a team that has really advanced therapy here at Tampa General's Cancer Center.
So the therapy today, and for years, has been the hallmark of being surgery and chemotherapy. The chemotherapy has changed. The concept of debulking, meaning to removing all the tumor, has been around for a long period of time. And what is known today and has been known for a long period of time, if we can get you to no residual disease at the first surgery, we have the best shot of curing it in those patients. Things have changed a little bit on the chemotherapy. They've come a long way. It's not only chemo, it's chemo-directed, meaning if we know if it's a genetic mutation called the BRCA, then we are into PARP inhibitors, which is a type of treatment. Or we also know that if we can get you no residual disease, there's an entity called HIPEC, where we heat the chemotherapy in the abdomen, and we can have a better prognosis for the patient.
And being part of an academic medical center and then the team here at the Tampa General Center, tell us about the team that's involved in this care.
So the team, when we take somebody, especially on the HIPEX, you need an anesthesiologist, you need a perfusionist, you need the patients that if they have problems in the pulmonary or cardiac side, so you need pulmonologists, you need cardiologists. Biggest problem with HIPEX is the possible problem. It can be kidney problems, meaning we cause the patient to have renal failure. So you need the patients to be able to have access to dialysis if you need it for a short period of time. Obviously, we're trying to prevent all that, so it comes back to the anesthesiologist to a large extent. The other thing that you have to be able to do is when you have a patient with an ovarian cancer, you have to get them to no residual disease. Many times these are big surgeries, meaning we can take out part of the liver, take out the gallbladder, take out the spleen, maybe resect part of the diaphragm, rebuild that, all the bowel resections, resect the bladder, take parts of the ureters out and rehook all this up. So you need a surgical team that's capable of handling all this in a fairly short, coordinated period of time.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much for your time today, Dr. Rutherford.
Well, thank you for having us.